Hanover Square Press and Harper Audio present Black Market, an insider's journey into the high-stakes world of college basketball by Merl Code. Read by James Shippy. Author note. This memoir is grounded, first and foremost, in my own experiences and memories. My stories were cross-referenced against interviews and correspondence with former teammates, families, coaches, colleagues and friends, and, where relevant, court documents. This specific narrative may be mine alone, but it illuminates the struggles of countless young athletes across multiple generations. I hope it inspires change. Prologue. Zion shifts his weight from side to side, looking around the room with a hint of shyness, almost embarrassment, as a man sings his praises to the cameras and a small crowd assembled to watch. It's part interview, part hype session. But when the man nudges him to introduce himself, he hesitates. "I'm Zion," the boy says, taking in a deep breath. "And I like to ball." "You're the number one player in your class," the man proclaims, clearly feeling like Zion is being a bit too understated. And the man is probably right. Zion is, after all, starting to build quite a buzz for himself in the basketball world. "Ain't nobody can hold you in your class," the man continues. "Nationally, you're on the map." "I definitely ain't backing down," Zion finally says, showing a hint of the self-confidence he exudes on the court. At this point, you are probably thinking to yourself, "I know who Zion is. The number one pick in the 2019 NBA draft. As a rookie with the New Orleans Pelicans, he was already an NBA megastar and one-man ratings bonanza, who'd secured a $75 million sponsorship deal with Nike's Jordan brand. His highlight videos got hundreds of millions of views online before he even set foot on Duke's campus or was named college basketball's Player of the Year. In only his second year as a pro, he became an NBA All-Star and one of the league's most marketable faces. All of that is true, but actually, you probably don't know Zion. Not this Zion, anyway. Because this isn't Zion Williamson we're talking about. It's Zion Lawson. This Zion is the number one player in the class of 2029. If you're doing the math in your head, you're right. He's 11 years old. He's on a Nike-sponsored travel team. They've already got highlights of their players splashed across various social media accounts. It's on. And if you want to know how this game really works, you've got to understand what the next 8 years of this kid's life, scratch that, all of these kids' lives, are going to be like. Now that they've been identified as top-tier players in their class, they're going to be shuttled through a system of branded basketball camps and clinics every spring and summer that are run by Nike, Adidas, and Under Armour. And Puma, who is trying to reestablish itself in the basketball market on the back of sponsorship deals with young up-and-comers like DeAndre Ayton, Michael Porter Jr., Marcus Smart, and the 2021 NBA Rookie of the Year, LaMelo Ball, will have something to say as well, along with New Balance, which recently inked a footwear and apparel deal with Boston College to outfit all of its athletic teams, and has Kawhi Leonard and young emerging NBA talent like Darius Bazley in the fold. Staffers from the brand their team is associated with, who are geographically positioned around the country, will interact with these kids or their people constantly. And depending on how highly ranked they are, that same staffer is shipping them product. Shoes, shirts, shorts, sweatsuits, socks, backpacks, whatever, on a weekly, monthly, or quarterly basis. The FedEx delivery man knows what's up. even though the names on the packages often change. That sneaker rep is like a year-round Santa Claus whose elves do nothing but make the hottest basketball gear, sometimes including stuff that hasn't and may never hit retail stores open to the general public. That's their job. That was my job. By the time they were in their mid-teens and college coaches came knocking, I knew damn near everything there was to know about a kid's family. I knew if Dad drank and flew off the handle. I knew if he was cheating. I knew if Mom needed a job because her company hit a rough patch and had to lay folks off. I knew who else was in their life. Uncles, cousins, random hangers, on hoping a talented kid might be their meal ticket. Mom wanted some new shoes? Done. The young man needed some winter clothes? I had you. By the time these kids were 16 and starting to consider where they wanted to go to college, nobody had a better relationship with them than I did. So now you can begin to understand why college coaches call sneaker reps when they're trying to start a relationship with a kid and his family. They've already been in there for years by then, and they know who's influential in the kid's life, who's got the juice. What? You thought these kids just magically show up at these camps? The coaches see them, they start being recruited, and next thing everybody knows they're on campus? Think about it. If you're that kid and his family, which school are you more likely to choose? One that's sponsored by the brand that's been outfitting you for years and helping your family, right? Not always, but definitely more often than not. When I was at Nike, we wanted them at Kentucky, Duke, North Carolina, or Oregon. At Adidas, we wanted them at the University of Kansas, Indiana, Louisville, North Carolina State, or Miami. Over at Under Armour, South Carolina, Auburn, or Wisconsin. The list could go on for each of those brands, but you get the idea. We're pumping hundreds of millions of dollars into sponsoring these programs, so we need them suiting up the best players, right? And then, when they turn pro a year or two later, it's time to make it official. Welcome to the family. Of course, you've been part of the family for a long time. And hopefully you were taken care of along the way, because you deserved it, no matter what the money-hoarding NCAA said. And there you have it. A decade-long process in which people drop in and out of a kid's life, but the sneaker rep is there for the entire journey. That's why the shoe companies have leverage at every pivotal moment. Sure, it's the money. But like everything in life, it's all about relationships. And that, more than anything else, was what my job was about. Relationships. Which is why I found myself being introduced to the stepdad of another Zion, Zion Williamson, at a Clemson University football game in 2015, even though they are a Nike school and I was working for Adidas at the time. But more on that story in a minute. When the FBI shocked the college basketball world with its 2017 announcement of charges in a corruption scandal, I was caught in a crossfire. That morning, I was in bed. It was a Tuesday, September 26. Early, around 6:15 a.m., my wife Candace, who has a PhD in occupational therapy and was pregnant with my son August at the time, and I had just returned from a surprise trip to Canada for her birthday. She was in the bathroom, getting ready to go to work. I heard somebody knocking at the door. It was still dark outside. Nobody in their right mind would be knocking that early in the morning. I jumped up out of the bed, still half asleep, and rushed downstairs to see what all the commotion was about. Aggravated, clad only in a t-shirt and underwear, I opened the door and was greeted by the shocking sight of close to 20 FBI officers on my porch, lawn, driveway, and the adjacent street. About 12 of them were outfitted in tactical gear, assault rifles raised and at the ready, the rest in plain clothes with handguns drawn. You would have thought that I was an international drug lord and murderous fugitive from justice. It was a bizarre scenario that seemed more like a horrific dream. The lead agent barked, Are you Merl Code? You're under arrest. For what? I'll tell you when you get in the car. Nope, tell me why I'm under arrest now. No, I'll tell you when you get in the car. Listen, man, I know enough about the law to know that you have to tell me why I'm under arrest. Money laundering. From whom? What are you talking about? The next thing I knew, one of the officers was playing a recording of me talking to Christian Dawkins, a young, up-and-coming sports agent that I'd mentored in the past. That's not a decision that I can make. That's an Adidas decision, and I will certainly ask Gato and see what they want to do. That was the first and last time I ever heard evidence of that call. You were involved in money laundering, said the officer. Then he started talking about wire fraud and whatever else. Shit, okay, whatever. An ensuing Yahoo Sports column said the federal charges had me facing a maximum of 80 years in prison. Adidas executives Merl Code and Jim Gato were widely known in the basketball industry as benevolent dealmakers, behind-the-scenes shakers and confidants of the sport's bold-faced names. That changed when Code and Gato became two of the 10 basketball industry figures arrested in the federal probe that's shaken the sport to its core. Wait, what? Shaken the sport to its core? That's when it began. The nightmare. The bullshit. My name, my picture, and video footage of me were splashed across every major newspaper, online outlet, and television news program throughout the country. I was mentioned alongside some of the biggest college coaches in the game. Louisville's Rick Pitino, Auburn's Bruce Pearl, Arizona's Sean Miller, LSU's Will Wade. But none of them ultimately faced any charges, and only Pitino lost his job as the head coach at the University of Louisville at the time. Sean Miller survived the initial storm, but was ultimately fired by the University of Arizona following the 2021 NCAA tournament for not winning enough games. Pitino has since returned to stalking the college basketball sidelines in Iona, despite two separate sex scandals prior to the FBI investigation that have littered his legacy as one of the greatest coaches of all time. So why would a small, private, Catholic college in New Rochelle, New York, with approximately 3,000 undergraduates, hire a coach who was seemingly so toxic a few short years ago? Because what happened at Louisville is par for the course in major college basketball, and it's been going on for over a century, and not too long after Dr. James Naismith invented the game in 1891. And toxic or not, Rick Pitino wins games and gets his teams to the NCAA tournament, which he accomplished in just his first year on the job in 2020-21. That translates into big money flowing in from television and proud alumni donors, not to mention lucrative sponsorship deals from sneaker and apparel companies, other revenue streams, and a chance to put Iona on the national basketball map. In essence, it's all about the money. Big money. And the machine doesn't stop. It just keeps on churning as the financial stakes continue to get bigger and bigger. So what was Pitino's final straw at Louisville, where he lorded over the most profitable college basketball program in the country for a university that monetized hoops better than any institution in America? The NCAA ruled that Louisville basketball recruit Brian Bowen, a certified future star who could single-handedly elevate the fortunes of the program, was ineligible because of payments that I helped facilitate at the request of his father and the Cardinals basketball program with the approval of both the Louisville and Adidas hierarchies. The NCAA has sold the myth of amateurism for decades. If you go to the NCAA website, they lay out the myth for everyone to see. Below are some situations that may impact a prospective student athlete's amateur status: receiving payment from a sports team to participate, receiving funds or money to offset training expenses, accepting prize money based on performance / finish at a competition, being represented or marketed by a professional sports agent, promoting or endorsing a commercial product or service, a money-making scheme to rake in billions of dollars, while the workers producing the product aren't allowed to profit themselves? Students of American history, or world history for that matter, will be tempted to say they've heard of this type of arrangement before. Indentured servitude is a nice way of calling it what it actually is, a form of slavery. So was I involved in breaking the rules of the NCAA's absurd system? Man, all of us were tiptoeing around and at some point stomping.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.